Think about this for a minute. You've got a, you said a 16-year-old son?
15.
15-year-old son, and what position is he playing?
He's a tight end.
All right. How big is he?
He is 6'1", 190.
And what school does he go to now?
DeMatha.
And now, we all know DeMatha cranks out a lot of good football players with excellent academic training that prepares them for a school like UVA. What schools is he looking at without getting too deep into it?
Choice there. You know, perhaps if Stanford or Harvard came talking to him, we'd have a dilemma in the household. But to the extent that he would have any shot at going to Virginia, he would go to Virginia. We like to have a democracy all the way up until it's time for a 15-year-old or an 18-year-old to make a decision, and then we have to take it.
All right, that sounds good. All right, you come to UVA. There's some pretty strong offensive linemen on that team, Bob Olderman and Jim Dombrowski. Does anybody remember those guys?
Yeah.
All right, so.
And Harold Guerin.
Yeah.
He was a freshman.
Yeah.
He didn't look like a football player. We were scared. He was the best lineman we ever. I mean, he was one of the best centers ever. He was unbelievable. Harold Guerin really brought to light one of those very important points about football. You can look like a good football player, or you can be a good football player. We had a lot of beautiful football players who couldn't play football. Harold was a very ugly football player that was a very good player. Wonderful. And I mean, we joke about that with Harold. He didn't look like a football player, but when the ball snapped, he always did his job. So on that side of the line, we had Harold at center, and then we had Bob Olderman next to him, and we had Dombrowski. So on the left side, I mean, if you're a running back, that's beauty right there.
All right, and was Zimmerlink the tight end at that time?
Gino was the tight end at that time.
Gino Zimmerlink, all right.
He was a very, very good one, too.
You know, just a few weeks ago, we had Kenny Stanlin here, who was the field goal kicker back in those days, and does a very marvelous imitation of George, which we're not going to go into that right now.
Nice.
But still makes me laugh. You know, Kenny talked about the fact that, you know, George really didn't talk a whole lot to him. Now, maybe that's just the way he treated special teamers, but I have a feeling that the head coach was talking to his running backs and quarterback quite a bit. Do you have a funny story or an interesting story or an illuminating story about George Welsh from those days?
Now, there are funny stories, but George, I think, is probably one of the finest coaches ever. His bedside manner wasn't as perhaps enchanting as some of these other coaches that are out there today. And Kenny pretty much hit the nail on the head. I mean, the funny stuff about George is the way he talked, right? That high-pitched voice. What are you doing? What the hell? And the funniest story, you know, and he would every once in a while do push Donnie out of the way and get behind the huddle and show you what the footwork was supposed to be like, and that was always funny to watch him. You know, George is a running back. You know, he'd get up there and he'd say, no, do it like this, and he'd do his thing. He always looked funny. So he was what a wonderful guy.
You know, Ray Roberts, who was on my show last year. Ray talked about one day in practice, George got so angry because the players actually were so fired up for the next opponent that a fight sort of broke out during practice, and George jumped on Ray's back.
And did.
Other players talk about that. Do you remember that?
I wasn't there for that, but I remember hearing about that.
I mean, I heard it was hilarious. And, you know, he just wouldn't let go. And finally, didn't he fall off and break his leg?
I thought he broke his leg getting in the play, trying to be the quarterback.
Yeah, okay. All right. Just want to make sure. All right. Let's get back to Howard Pitt. All right, so you come to Virginia. You did not have high expectations. Back in those days, they didn't give you 3, 4, 5, 6 stars for anything. It was either you were the blue chip or a maybe or a project, or that's about it. But you come to Virginia with sort of modest expectations. But you get here and all of a sudden you start finding out, hey, you know, you can play, you're going to contribute, and right from the gate, you started putting up some significant yards and scoring touchdowns. talk a little bit about the team itself, because I think maybe that's indicative of the tone of the whole team. Because the team, none of these players, before George got here, they couldn't win games.
Yeah, and I was redshirted, so the actual freshman year, we were 2-9. I mean, I can remember Scott Hellman, we played the first game we ever played under the lights was against Clemson. They drove the lights here and set them up. And that was a big deal, and ESPN was doing this, and a Thursday night game, and everybody was all excited, and they beat us 49-0. But the worst part about that wasn't the beating 49-0. Our fullback, Scott Hellman, they hit him so hard, they knocked his helmet off, and then they knocked it, and the shoe came off too. So as a player, I mean, it's one thing if you lose one item. If you lose two items, I mean, what do you go get first? You get your shoe over there or your helmet over there? I mean, they beat us that bad. It was awful. But I didn't have any expectations coming at all. He inherited some very, very good athletes. I mean, Alderman and Dombrowski were already here. As Gino, I think, was one of the best tight ends out there. He was a smaller guy, but he could catch, he could run really good routes. We had a good class that came in, but what nobody knew at that time was how to win. And I think that was the magic that George offered up, that he took a team that was 1-10 in 1 year, 2-9 the next year, his first year, and he taught everybody how to win. And really, he just had a few principles that he continued to go over. And really, it all emanated from the values that you had on the practice field. So he taught us how to practice, and then that translated into wins on the game field. And I think that was the magic that he brought to Virginia, is teaching us how to practice.
All right, Virginia's had some great running backs over the years. Marcus Wilson, Terry Kirby, Tiki Barber, Thomas Jones, Wally Lovey, yourself, Barry Word.
I wouldn't describe my name in
that. Oh, you were a terrific running back. Give me a break. So let's go back and talk about that Peach Bowl year and some of those games. And all of a sudden, it becomes pretty obvious Virginia's building a pretty significantly decent offense. And you beat Virginia Tech down there. Kenny Statlin drilled that 56-yard field goal that still tied the UVA record. Although the team trailed, John Ford and Mikowski throw the long bomb on fourth down.
Fourth down and an inch.
Right.
Did you know it was an inch?
And you know, George said.
Maybe a foot, but it was George, a short distance.
George said on our show last year, he said that he had designed a few plays that he would go for it on fourth and short, if the right situation came up, and he made up his mind that week in practice. Now,
and he practiced that play, and that play was second nature, and it's 25, 30 years later, and I can tell you right now what that play was. I mean, we were running the option. The thing about football that's so important, and I think the thing that translates into everyday life as you move forward beyond the game, that practice component. If you go out there today, I guarantee the quarterbacks and centers the first thing you're going to see them doing is that exchange. In practice, those guys get out before practice and do that, and they stay out after practice and they do that because it has to be second nature. It has to be, you know, that muscle memory on how to do it. But for us, since we were an option team, yeah, they did the center quarterback exchange, but they also had the running backs out there. And so then the next piece was for the quarterback to get the ball, ride the fullback, go two steps down, and then without looking, pitch to the running back. And it was the running back's responsibility to be in the right relationship so that if the ball was pitched, you were there to get it. The play that we beat Virginia Tech with, instead of going to the pitch, you ride the fullback, and you immediately take two steps back, look up, and John Ford's running a post. Practice, 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 practice. I bet you we ran that play that week more than 50 times. And we got the timing down, and we were all very excited in the huddle when he called the play. But I got to tell you, it was really cold, and it was a shock. We had no clue it was coming. No clue at all that he was going to call that play. And we had no clue that he was going to catch it. I mean, that really was a major piece of the season. And that was, what, like the seventh game or so?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Did you know that we lost the first game? To Clemson?
That's correct. That was
the 49-0. That was just like the year.
I was there.
Yeah.
It still hurt. But what was great is the team came back all season and put together, what, 8 or 9 wins?
Yeah. No, we put 8 wins together. So right. We were 8-1, 8-1-1. The interesting thing about that season, though, is that we started off against Clemson 49-0 again. But this year we had a hand in. I mean, we weren't actually bad. Then we weren't as prepared as we needed to be. We spent a lot of time. We had a team, but we couldn't beat Clemson. We had a brain lock. We're going to talk a little bit about this. But we had a brain lock on two teams. One of them was Clemson, the other one was Maryland. Everybody else, you know, we could at least figure out a way to be competitive and perhaps win the game. But with Clemson and Maryland, there was just something there where we couldn't win the game. So in the summertime, coaching staff spent a lot of time trying to win that one game. And when we came into summer camp, they had Barry and I split out at tight at split ends and stuff running. I mean, we just had weird stuff going on. We lost 49-0. We came back in on Sunday. We didn't look at the films. And we took everything out to 3 running plays and 3 passing plays. And every week, we put 1 or 2 in. The Virginia Tech week, we put long pass in. But another principle from George is, you know, keep it simple. You know, we got all that mess out of there. He recognized he made a mistake. We lost that game. That's fine. Now let's go back to blocking and tackling. We started all over again, and we slowly progressed one win at a time.